Hello guys, so yesterday we have seen what all factors affect the price elasticity of demand, or basically any elasticity of demand. So when you talk about elasticity, what we saw yesterday were some of the factors like availability of substitute, the level of income, the level of price, all these things, and remaining factors we are going to study today. Now, depending on the nature of commodities, their available substitutes, the elasticity changes. It means the degree of elasticity changes. They can either be elastic or be inelastic. Let's move forward. The next factor affecting the price elasticity or the elasticity of demand is the postponement of demand. What do you mean by postponement of demand? It means those commodities or those products which you can, whose demand you can postpone. Means if today say you want to purchase product A, but it is not a necessity, you can purchase it later also. So those products can be purchased later, means their demand can be changed. So when you say there is a chance of postponement of demand, it becomes elastic. Means where there is a chance of postponement, your degree of elasticity is that it is a elastic demand. But for example, let's say there are some demands like a life-saving drug. Let's say tomorrow you hear that there is some vaccine for corona. What are you gonna do? However expensive it is, you will want to purchase that. Means a life-saving drug, or say a necessity without which you cannot do, are inelastic. Those demands which you cannot postpone, which are the urgent wants, depending on the level of urgency, you can say that you cannot postpone it. Means you cannot change the demand, so the demand becomes inelastic. The degree of responsiveness is very restricted, making it inelastic. Okay, so postponement of demand means if you can postpone, means you can change, so it is elastic. If you cannot postpone, means if it is very, very urgent, if it is an emergent demand, then you won't be able to change, meaning it has an inelastic demand. Moving forward, the next one is number of users. Now here, a very important term I'll tell you, that it is just not because you have to define it somewhere, it is because in economics you will use it many a times. When you say a product has composite demand, you mean that the product can be used in multiple ways. So number of users means the product has a composite demand. Now what do you mean by composite? Composite means, let's say for example, electricity, water, these are the resources that you might use for n number of purposes, right? So those commodities which can be used for multiple purposes have composite demand. So it is very obvious that what happens when per unit of electricity charge increases, your mom will tell you, don't waste electricity unnecessary. Switch off the light, switch off the fan when you come out of the room. What is she trying to do? She is trying to change the consumption of electricity for unnecessary stuff, and then you will use it for more important purposes. It means if the nature of demand is composite, your degree of responsiveness is highly elastic. Means you will want to, if the prices are rising, you will want to cut down on less important purposes or the luxury purposes, the entertainment purposes, and you will want to use it for more important ones. So if I say, what is the degree of responsiveness or what is the elasticity of demand for a product having multiple uses, you immediately understand that it is a composite demand, and that is why the degree of responsiveness is elastic. Got it? Now moving forward, I am telling you the share in total expenditure also affects the degree of responsiveness of demand. Now what do you mean by share in total expenditure? Now in economics, these small terms like cost, price, expenditure, revenue, income, all these things mean very specific. Like in layman term, in our general term, we tend to use these words very carelessly. But you have to understand that when you say cost, you always mean the cost at which you are purchasing a product. When you say price, it means the price at which somebody is selling it. Okay? So when I say share in total expenditure, it means the expenditure that you are making, the price into quantity. When you say expenditure, what do you mean? Price into quantity. This is your expenditure. This price is not your expenditure, because if say one unit of product is rupees 10, you are spending 10 into, let's say you have purchased two quantities, so your total expenditure is going to be 20. But let's say your income is just rupees 50. So from 50, you are spending 20 rupees for consumption of certain goods. Okay, so another consumer who might have, let's say, 35 rupees as income, and he also spends rupees 20 for purchasing certain products. Now, whose share is more? The share in total expenditure is more of person B. So when you say the share in total expenditure is more, you mean to say that you are always, you will be ready to save at least a rupee if it is possible. Because here the person is saving only 15 rupees and here the person is saving 30 rupees. So this person obviously has less income, so he will want to save more and more. Even a penny, even 1 rupee difference, he will always want to go for a relatively cheaper product. Means he is ready to change his demand. So when you say that the share in total expenditure is more, you will have elastic demand. When I will say the share is more, you will be ready to shift your demand. Hence the responsiveness, the elasticity will be more, means it will be elastic. And when your share is less, means you have ample of money as saving, so you are maybe having an extra income, then that income you can readily spend if the price is increased by nominal percentage. So where the share of expenditure is less, then you can say it is a inelastic demand. Okay, next is time period. Now what do you mean by time period? In economics, the entire time period, be it a day, a week, a month, a year, whatever, is just divided into short run and long run. In short run, you are very reluctant. Let's say, for example, you have just started studying these things online, right? You have just started to do this and somebody says, okay, let's just stop this process and let's just shift to something else. What will you say? Wait, let me get accustomed to this one, let me get familiar to this technique, and then I will probably move to something else. Let's say if I teach you a method one of measuring elasticity, and in amidst that I tell you, wait, let's change it to some other, what will you say? Wait, let us first do this method, then we will shift to the next. Means in the short run, people are very hesitant, people are very reluctant to change, means their demand is inelastic. But in the long run, the consumer understands that with change in price, he can change his demand, he can earn more profit, he can take his decisions wisely. So, but it takes time. Somebody doesn't become wise in one given day or one given week, right? It depends on nature of every consumer, even his nature of consumption, his pattern of consumption, his urgency of wants, all of this. But in all, we can determine or we can conclude that in time period, when the time period is short run, means you are consuming for a very small time, you have just started, then you are very reluctant to change your habits or your preferences, so your demand will be inelastic. But in the long run, when you are very familiar with the market conditions and your pattern of consumption, you will be easily changing it when the other factors change, means the consumption becomes elastic. And the last point that we are going to study for factors affecting elasticity are the habits. Now, I don't think that I need you to, you know, I need to explain so much about this point, because if you have a habit of certain things, like for example, now many of you are very like hitched to PUBG, right? Whatever we say, leave that game, but you are very reluctant. You won't do it, right? So whenever your habits certain demands are habitual demands. Certain goods are habitual goods. The best example in economics that is used for habitual goods is alcohol, or say let's say tobacco, cigarettes and stuff, which are, you know, drug uses. If those habits are the products that you are going to demand, then whatever factor change, your demand will be, say, inelastic, correct? So if the goods are habitual, you will not want to change them even if the prices are increasing, right? So it means that you are not ready to change, you are not ready to shift, or you are not ready to cut down on the demand, meaning that the degree of responsiveness is inelastic. Okay, so let's just take a quick recap of whatever we have studied about factors affecting the elasticity of demand. First, we studied that if the goods are necessities, you might as well not cut down because they are necessary for survival, making it inelastic demand. If there are multiple substitutes available, means those are, you know, very elastic in nature, means if one grocery shop owner increases the price by 10%, the other grocery shop owner does not do anything, means he automatically becomes a little cheaper, so you will shift there because there are availability of substitutes. The more the substitutes, the more elastic is your demand. Then if you are a person earning more income, like if you have an income level which is higher as compared to someone else, so if it is higher, then you are not much influenced by the change in price. You can still afford it. So if you can afford it, you won't, you know, have to choose between multiple products. You don't have to change your consumption pattern, making your demand less sensitive to change in price, means inelastic. Whereas when you talk about middle income group people or poor people, what happens, even if they get something at 10 rupees cheaper, it means a lot to them, so they will immediately shift to the relatively cheaper product, making their demand elastic, correct? Then we come about prices. When the goods are very expensive and there is a slight change in price, then you will definitely move towards that product if the prices are decreasing, making it highly elastic, highly susceptible to change, right? And when those are inexpensive goods, like say needles, matchbox, these are like having a very small share in your expenditure, so you, like if they increase even by 1 rupee, you're not going to bother much. Those are inexpensive, so the elasticity is very less. They're less sensitive, means they are inelastic. And remaining things we studied today, like the postponement, if you can postpone, means you can change, means it is elastic. If there are multiple uses, means the composite demand, then definitely it is elastic. You can cut down on one use and use it for more other. Share, if there is more share in total expenditure, it is elastic. Then time period, long run and short run, and then finally the habits. Now these are the factors that affect elasticity. We have also seen what is price elasticity, what are the measures of price elasticity. Now as the final part of this chapter, I am going to tell you about two more elasticities, that is income elasticity and cross elasticity. Now the basic three parts of elasticity that you are going to study in this entire syllabus is the price elasticity, means the demand is changing due to change in price. But we also know that other factors also affect the demand, means we have seen that in shift. The other factors may include income. Basic example, that even the prices are high and your income is also good, so you will not bother about price, right? So income is also a factor affecting the elasticity. So income elasticity. And the last is price of related products also determine the degree of our responsiveness. So that one is called as cross elasticity. Let's move forward to the final two types of elasticities. So when you say income elasticity, you can frame your own definition, means the responsiveness of demand to change in income is your income elasticity of demand, right? So if I have to put this symbolically, you know, even if I don't write, you will be able to understand it. If I say income elasticity means the affecting factor here is income, which is always denoted by Y. So it will become delta Y. And what is changing due to income? Your quantity demanded. It means delta Q upon delta Y. But it is always proportional. So you will say Y upon Q, where Y and Q are your original income levels. And when the income level changes, the quantity demanded also changes. Now, depending on all other factors, you can determine whether the change in income is elastic or it is inelastic. So this is the formula for measuring income elasticity. And obviously, you know that the basic thing that you have to keep in mind, the underlying factors you always have to keep in mind when you are measuring price elasticity, the underlying factor that is always going to be stuck in your subconscious is the law of demand. P up, D down. P down, D up. Similarly, when you talk about income, you always know there is a positive relation. Means with increase in income, your demand is also going to increase. But when you talk about elasticity, you have to consider various factors that might affect your demand. Right? Okay, moving forward. Is my cross elasticity. When you say cross, you always mean it to be elasticity due to change in prices of related products. Cross elasticity. So cross elasticity is nothing but the degree of responsiveness that my product has due to change in price of the related products. Now you know that the related products can either be substitutes or be complements. Correct? So what is the price demand relationship in case of substitutes? We know that the price demand relationship in case of substitutes is what? Positive or negative? Let's see. If the prices of my substitute increase, it means the consumers of those substitutes will shift to my product, means the demand for my original goods, let's say X, will definitely also increase. So it gives you positive relationship. Positive what relationship? Price demand relationship. When the price of some other product increases and that product is related to my product, the demand for my product will also increase because the substitute's price are increasing, their demand will decrease and those customers will come and select my product which is relatively cheaper. It is opposite in case of complements, because in complements the consumer cannot shift to mine because they will have to demand both the products together in order to fulfill a single want. So if I say the prices of my complement product increase, making the want very expensive, that is why ultimately the demand for my product, let's say X, will happen to decrease. Means once the prices are increasing, my demand will decrease because both the complements are related, right? If one complement good, if one good becomes expensive, my entire satisfaction of one demand becomes expensive, so I will cut down on the demand. Means if the price is up, the demand goes down. That is why it indicates a negative price demand relationship, right? So when we have studied all this and then we compare this everything to the elasticity of demand, you know that the cross elasticity of demand is nothing but what is the base for changing this cross elasticity, what is the base for changing the demands for my product X, are the prices of other commodities. You can say the prices of Y, whatever change is in the prices of other goods will change the quantity of my goods. And then you know what you have to do? You have to do the opposite. What is it? Py upon Qx. This was the original price of Y and this was the original quantity of my consumers. But what happens later is that a change in my related product prices will change the demand for my product. So the base is nothing but change in P of Y. You don't have to mug up the formula, I am telling you again, because whatever is causing to change your demand is your base, means is your denominator. Okay, so basically we have finished the chapter here, we have completed it, but we have to take certain numerical examples which will be our next exercise. Okay.